Hello, Laura Donnelly here from Dancing with Ease, Body Brain Balance. And we have another episode. Oh boy, I'm so excited. Of the Healing Path. And the Healing Path is a series of conversations with healers who are working in all kinds of modalities. I started this back in 2020, in June of 2020, when I realized that everything was going to go on in a kind of disjumbled way. And that everybody, me included, needed ways to return to a center, return to ourselves, to stay connected to what was really important for us, so that we could move forward with grace and authenticity. And so I started these conversations because I realized I know lots of people who are working in healing, and best of all, now I'm meeting more and more people. So, you know, I get excited. So this is also about the fact that there's no one single modality for healing. There's no one path. There's no one way to heal. And the people who come on and share their stories with me and with you, the thing we have in common is the idea that all healing starts with self-healing. And self-healing really is this decision. Somewhere, something inside of us makes this decision to heal. And then the right people show up, the right modalities show up, the right adventures for healing show up, the right doctor, the right process, and each step unfolds. So today, my lovely guest is Marlene Neumann, and she's coming to visit us from South Africa. I'm so excited. She's going to share a little bit about her story of how she used photography on her healing journey. So I'll bring Marlene into the studio here. Hi, Marlene.
Hello, Laura. So excited. I can't believe you're all the way in Kansas, and here I am in South Africa. I just love this technology.
I know. And it's so exciting. And this is one of the things that I think I didn't realize it when I started this series, but that all around the world, there are healers and people sharing good work. And I can share this through this medium so that even more people can find each other in places. You know, when I was growing up, my cousin lived 30 minutes away. We didn't even call on the phone. We sent letters.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, we'd never have met without the internet. So I feel really blessed about that. So please tell people a little bit about your life, your history, photography, whatever you would like to share.
Thanks, Laura. Whew, it's been quite a journey, an exciting journey, and a very interesting one. I was putting together, at the moment I'm putting together a body of work and a talk that I'm doing for the Canadian photographers. And one of the things that I realized is that photography has been my life, actually, since I was 14 years old. I took my first picture. And one of the things I realized is that I really struggled. I came from a German background, and I really struggled to communicate in my emotions and my feelings. And once I picked, our local school had a darkroom. And so I'm darkroom trained, and our local school had a darkroom, and I printed my first picture at the age of between 14 and 16 years old. And there was something in there, Laura, there was something in that moment that I realized that, I don't know, there was just something. And I did another one and another one, and I started to get higher marks and good marks and things. Anyway, long story short, I went on to college and I studied graphic design, but photography, there was something about capturing the moment. And there was just something about, I don't know, it was that split second. I mean, how could anyone not be excited about that? About that moment in time that no one could ever see again. And I studied and went through, you know, getting a master's in photography, but it was never that I really ever even understood how the camera really worked. It was like something that I just was born inside of me, and it was the connection the connection, it was like the, I could see these beautiful things and I could photograph them and then I could share them with other people. And what fascinated me in all my years of 35 years of doing photography, I only really shoot black and white.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. The black and white have, I don't know, there's just something very mystical and magical. And tonight, today, I actually want to share some of my images with you later on. And then you could maybe also understand what it is that I was, in my very first photograph, when I studied as a student, I'm going to share with you. Wow. And what I noticed, though, and I didn't notice this until many years later, until my journey, my healing journey really started, when at 38 I had breast cancer. And I overcame all of that, and I noticed as I went on and on, why was I photographing what I photographed? And I realized that I was actually photographing my emotions.
Oh, wow.
I was photographing, they were like metaphors for what I felt deep inside. Somehow I managed to, and although when I was writing my thesis, I studied Alfred Stieglitz. Maybe there's some photography or painters. Georgie O'Keeffe was married to Alfred Stieglitz.
He's one of my favorites.
Yes. And so he was my hero. So it is a bit of a jumbled story of my life. But the beautiful part of it is that the one thing that was really stable for me in my life was my photography. It just kept me grounded. And I noticed that I started to even photograph my moods. So it was almost as though life was a metaphor for me. And I was capturing, if I was feeling maybe down or sad, or I didn't realize this, but dried old leaves would appeal to me. Or if I was feeling more withdrawn, or, you know, something else that had that feeling. It was a very interesting journey, actually. And I started to realize that, and you'll see in the earlier work, something was happening. Something, this young girl of 23 years old had come in with something. I tease my students and I say, well, I must have been Alfred Stieglitz's assistant or something, or something like that, because how did I know this? I didn't know it, but there was an innate knowing. There was an innate knowing of, there was nothing more important than nature. Nature. Nature was just everything and all. You know, sometimes I wrote down here, what was I going to say today? And I said, I felt sometimes I'd fallen on my head when I came into this life because I just didn't fit in. I didn't fit into the school system. I didn't fit. So I almost felt like I was, if I look back, I was trying to identify. But the only thing that was really real for me, who I really was my images, my pictures that I took. And I felt like I could see nature for what it truly was by capturing it. You know, photography is a very mystical, it's a mystery, and it's magical, and it's a deeply spiritual process. I almost want everyone to, I mean, it's so accessible now with your cell phone, isn't it? It's just, you can capture, you know, you can capture nature. So I don't know if you want me to go on with more of my story, or, you know, what I did, or if you want to have a look at the pictures and we can talk about it. How do you...
I think it would be nice if you would show some of the pictures and mm-hmm. talk about whatever comes up to you to talk about the photo, about, you know, maybe why you took it or when you Absolutely. Realized what this photo was about. Because sometimes I see something and I take a picture with my cell phone, for which I am incredibly grateful, because I have it with me and I see something and I can capture some facsimile of it. Many times, the photo I take, well, okay. So I live here where the sky is huge, right? And the horizon is huge. And so many times I want to take a picture of the sunset, but the sunset here, it goes 360 degrees around the sky. You know, it could be blazing in the west.
Yeah, yeah.
Lavender in the north. Pink in the east and peach colored in the south. Well, sometimes I just stand there and turn around in a circle and take pictures so I can remember that. But it never is what my eye saw. Mm-hmm. But other times, mm-hmm. my eye captures something through the camera that has a meaning, but it's even though it's not what I saw. Mm-hmm. And so I'm just like, sometimes it blurs, you know, and I keep it because I'm like, well, that was blurry, but in the blurry, it looks more like a ghost or something, you know? And
yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, I rarely take pictures of people.
Yeah, rarely. Me never. I never take pictures of people. You know, but you know, Laura, just listening to what you're saying and hearing you is that what has happened to me is that on my path and on my journey, because I've also been teaching for the past 35 years, and teaching what we call intuitive photography. So, and later on, in the last maybe 5-6 years, I found a lot of connection. There were so many Buddhist monks that were in actual fact photographers. Because I run a workshop called Soul Photography, and which is, I'm busy with one now. And, you know, the whole part of my life, for example, when the cancer came at the age of 38, I had to change my diet. I had to change my eating. My whole life changed 360 degrees. And so even on the Soul Photography Workshop, it's run like a proper retreat where people, students learn about Komarebi, for example, which is the Japanese art of light filtering through the trees. And, you know, we learn about wabi-sabi. And so all this is part of photography. So photography, unfortunately, it's been made into a sport, and it isn't. It isn't a sport, not if you're doing photography. You know, as I said to you, I studied all the old masters, the 1940 American photographers, Alfred Stieglitz, Minor White, Aaron Siskind. All of those men were in my life. And you know, when you see what they were searching for, it wasn't what a lot of people are searching for in, you know, we allow the camera to do because it's just an extension. And if I look at my work, my early work, and I look at my later work, and I look at my work now, and I look at what I'm teaching now, I can see myself changing. As I changed, my photographs changed. So that is why when I teach photography, it's photography. When I teach, the student says, I work on the student. I work on their emotions. And I work on the mentorship with them. And we move them within. And as they move within, so they start to see different things. It is fascinating. It is, and I've got some students that would never, ever have gotten onto the healing path, you know, but somewhere in their life, their soul drew us together. And of course, last year was just actually as terrible as COVID was. It was good for me because I'd never even heard of Zoom, you know, so I had to really, you know, get myself sorted. And from that, I was doing talks on what it means to wake up. And because I'm known as a photographer, a fine art photographer, it drew photography people to me. And within that, I was able to take them on this journey. And I mean, I now run online meditation workshops for my photography students so that they can start raising in consciousness and vibration. That teaching them that you know, things are in different dimensions. You know, what we see is actually not really what we think we see. It's the camera sees other things. The camera sees what the eye doesn't see, actually. And that's what excited me, you know, if I think way back. And I link it all the way back to Alfred Stieglitz, to those Buddhists, to all those people. And so lately, I teach a lot of contemplative photography, where we have to get ourselves into the right state before we go out and take a photograph. We have to learn to tune in. I mean, my students even go through an afternoon of animal communication. because that is so, so my journey has taken me on so many things, you know, to produce what it is. It's a way of life.
It is a way of life. I was reminded while you were talking about that of I have that quote that has been in my life for years and years, and it came in a dream, and it said, "What you see is determined by how you focus the light."
Oh gosh, Laura, that's beautiful.
I know. The dream was very mundane, right? I'm sitting on an airplane, and they turn the lights off on the plane, and I want to read, so I reach up to turn on the light, and then the booming voice comes in and says that quote. You know, it's like I woke up and I wrote the quote down.
Wow.
And I'm like, oh wow, that was a serious message, you know, because it goes to gratitude practice, right?
Everything.
That if you, even when things are darkest in my life, you know, I can be grateful for a warm shower. You know, that, I mean, and then that just that little shift, the tiniest shift.
Yeah, exactly.
Gives you a little bit of space, a little bit of healing. And like, I love what you said is that you can look back at your photos and kind of see the journey that you went on and the changes, maybe the changes in how you were looking. I don't know. Is that interesting?
I think for me, you know, my healing path, I mean, two years ago, I broke my hip. I was running on the beach with my dogs and I slipped and fell backwards. Thank goodness it was my back. And I broke my hip and my left wrist. But, you know, that was a 3-month journey of healing and learning how to walk. That is the fastest way we can actually get, because I couldn't move. And I thought, wow, what am I learning here? This deep stillness. And, you know, Laura, that stillness has never left me. So that I've incorporated into my work, you know, that... And teaching the students how to be that still without having to break their hip and be totally. So it's just, I get so excited about, you know, this whole process. And yeah, so can I share some stuff with you?
Just do the sharing screen, and I'll let everybody know that we learned how to share the screen this morning, and it's just so exciting to be able to see some of your photographs.
So you'll see the first one. There we go. Is it up?
It's up. There's you.
Yeah. And now it's just me in my younger days in the desert. So I don't, you know. Yeah.
Which in desert? The
this is the Namibian desert. Namibia, which is, I spent a lot of time in the desert. Even there's got all sorts of stories and hidden things inside the desert. So I wanted to put this in for you, because this was one of the very, very first images that I ever took, Laura. It was actually a black feather. And I was talking to your friend this morning about this image and how using, because I studied all the old darkroom people and, you know, using negative and positive shapes and things. But this feather, it was also almost became like alchemized, because it went from the dark to the light. So I love this. And you know, one of the original names of this image was Spindrift. And Spindrift was the spray blown from the crest of waves by the wind. Isn't that a beautiful word? Hey, geez. So what I love about capturing images, and I don't even want to say call it photography, because it becomes very exclusive and limited to, you know, only people who know how to work their cameras. But so I love calling it, you know, just capturing a part of the whole, because I feel that's, you know, that's what it is. So these are some of my early works I just wanted to share with you, with me, and they're all done in the darkroom. You know, there's no digital. Can you see even in the subconscious mind, you know, the metaphorical stuff that was happening? You know, the one on the right, you know, very much reminds me of like the Matrix.
Yeah.
You know, I just wonder what my subconscious mind was already. These I was 23 years old when I was doing these. I mean, just look at that. And a very strange thing happened a while ago. And some of you might even have that book called, I don't know what it was called, but it was by Edgar Cayce. And years later, I found, after I'd taken this, I found that he had actually had one of these images, not this, but similar, on the front of his book.
Wow.
So there was always something a bit peculiar about me, actually. looking back, Laura, it's almost like I didn't fit into any box. I was like a little box of my own, you know? But I just felt like these were magical. And I mean, that was just a reflection on the water, you know, that I was fascinated by. I mean, there's so many fascinating things around you, you know? Laura, stop me because I get too enthusiastic and I just carry on talking.
You know, it's wonderful. I last night I was driving home and it was the full moon, and yeah. I went over the bridge by the river, and the moon made this line on the river, and I wanted to photograph it, but it's too dangerous to stop on the bridge.
Yeah.
But it reminded me of another time when I was riding on the ferry, the Staten Island ferry in New York, and the full moon was shining on the wake of the boat.
Wow.
So then this image and the swirly, I'm like, I never saw a swirly reflection like that.
Yeah.
And I'm like, wow. And the other thing about photographs, right? In 2 or 3 seconds, that whole image could have changed.
It's gone. Yeah.
And so there's a way that photography reminds us of the transitory nature of life, just in its ability to capture those little things.
Absolutely. Yeah. And you know, I mean, as you say, Laura, you know, once one is taught how to look and see, you know, this is just that was just using a torch, you know, and just playing with light. I always said it was a drunk firefly, but it was actually someone with a torch. I can't tell you when last I've brought out this old work. I mean, I'm now 56, and this I was taking when I was probably, 23 years old? It's a long time ago, you know? This is some of my later work.
This is where my heart is, in this expansive landscape.
Yeah, so it wasn't about, so when I train people or students, I don't teach them to go and look for photographs. So it's an emotional experience. You know, this is what was going on inside of me emotionally when I saw this. So this is also in one of the Namibian deserts. And the title of this work is called Journey Home. And it reminds me, I mean, it must have reminded me of the journey home that we're all on. We're all on that journey home, aren't we?
And the road goes off into the distance, and we don't know what's going to show up.
No, we don't.
Around the next bend.
And Laura, those gates were exactly like that. Exactly like that. So that's another thing, is that none of the images are cropped. I haven't cropped an image in 35 years. So everything is exactly as I've taken it. This is also an interesting thing, because this technique that you're seeing here, so just bearing in mind, this is all darkroom and done with film. It later on actually became what they call the Neumann technique. But from studying the old masters, I actually worked with all these chemicals. And this image, I'd spent some time in India. I had this negative for about 2 years before I actually produced this image. And I always felt like the longer you held the image, the energy of the image, you know, the more powerful and the more energetic the image would, you know, would be able to release, you know, release energy. It's beautiful. So that's where I live, Laura.
Right here, this is where you live?
My surrounding area is like this, with big aloes and rolling hills and grasses and, yeah.
Wow. It's beautiful. Just beautiful.
Yeah. So also for me, you know, the healing journey was, this is the time where I was struggling. You know, struggling emotionally, struggling internally. You can see what I was photographing. Look at the survivor in the aloes, in the hard grounds that they, you know, how they survive. I mean, they endure enormous pain. They endure extreme hot temperatures and drought. And you know what? They still flower. When it comes to June here in South Africa, they still manage to flower.
So, well, so the it's the aloe that you use for healing, right? You break off the limb and it's so it, I love that plant. I used to live in Arizona, and so we had not
lots
tall.
Of aloes.
It wasn't tall like that. It was a more ground-based aloe, but it. I don't know, there's something about it that makes me smile. I think it's their persistence, you know?
That's it, the endurance of what they, I mean, Arizona is also very arid.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they like that. And it's like us, you know, the different things that we've gone through our lives, in our childhood, in our, you know, whatever illnesses we've suffered, whatever it is we've gone through. For me, they're a metaphor for humans. Because, I mean, this middle one, to me, they actually look like little people, you know? Surviving and standing, and this is a baobab tree, up here in South Africa. Beautiful healing. You know, I found, Laura, I later found people would come to my exhibitions and things, and sometimes they would just stand and stare. And I never, it was never about me taking the photographs. It was about the photographs showing themselves to me, if that makes sense. They wanted to, there were parts of the whole, they wanted to be captured. This tree wanted to be captured, if that makes sense.
Well, it wanted more people to see it than could see it where it was.
Exactly. I mean, you're right now in Kansas and you're seeing it. This is one of my favorite images. And I always feel like when I'm feeling, you know, a bit too much in my head and my head is busy, I always feel I just go and stand in front of this image, and it just calms me, and it just takes me right back to this desert. This is the Kalahari Desert here in South Africa, and it's basically where the Bushmen used to live. I always feel quite emotional when I look at this image, because it was, I think most of us on this healing path, we've had quite a time, haven't we? That's why we're on the self-healing path and the healing path.
Here's the thing. I think one time, look at that. Oh man, the sky and the land. Okay. I've been thinking about this lately. This is so interesting because I've been thinking about it. And the camera kind of captures moments of what is. And like you said, sometimes it captures what the eye doesn't see. Oh, look, that looks like a lizard. That
yes.
That, oh. See, I can just stand and stare at these all day. Each one is like a little poem.
Yeah. They're actually a book.
Oh, right. You made the book. I remember you made the book. Yeah. Okay. Well, we have to put a link. You'll give me the links afterwards. So, and see where you live. The sky is like here. The sky is always changing, but it is always framing the space. Now, look, you have sunflowers too.
That's you also have sunflowers there.
What? Are they sunflowers?
Yeah, they're sunflowers. Yeah.
It's our state flower.
Really? Oh my gosh. I'm just flipping through so that I'm listening to while you're chatting, Laura. It's just lovely to hear what you're saying about the sky and.
Well, and this idea of what is, and to be okay in the moment with what is.
Yeah.
And the idea. My grandma had a can like that.
I'll stop flipping through.
No, keep flipping. It's fine, because however it goes is fine, because other people will be having other memories and other feelings invoked by your images.
I'll tell you the story about this can. I actually took it in India. I took myself off to India to an ashram for about 3 weeks, And I did kitchen duty and garden duty, because then at least I could know what I was eating in, you know, when we were picking the stuff. And while I was working in the garden, I saw this watering can. And I just, for me, and I only came home with one photograph from India after 3 weeks, and it was this one. For me, this just portrayed the whole essence, the whole culture, the whole everything, the beauty, you know, how you can take something so old and make it so beautiful, and how there's no wastage. You know, normally most people would take an old watering can and throw it away and buy a new plastic one. You know, how the healing, just the healing of this can, this, to me, this was wabi-sabi, you know, on its own. Just, it's so beautiful, Laura. It's just beautiful. If I could have brought that can home with me, I would have.
Right. Well, and the idea that what we were talking about, healing being challenging, who said ever that life wasn't supposed to be challenging?
Exactly. Yeah.
I mean, that's just what is. And then what we make of it. You know, like this watering can. Somebody said, oh, there's more life in this watering can.
Yes.
But I was thinking about water and nurturing and watering plants. I mean, I was thinking about all the metaphors of what a watering can is.
Yeah.
In relationship to being at the ashram. And
but also, it was, you know, I think a lot of us Westerners go to places like that because we're feeling broken. And, you know, and maybe in a way I was photographing my brokenness, and just how this, you know, I'm thinking of the metaphors whenever I photograph, you know, and just in that moment, you know, just in that moment, there was this beautiful watering can. You know, we gave it a name, but energetically it was just so symbolic of how a lot of us feel sometimes, you know, when we're getting a bit older. You know, we've got the cuts and the bruises and the scars and the but we're so beautiful.
Well, you know things that other people don't know.
You're right.
Seagulls, right?
Laura, this is actually what we call here a sacred ibis.
Oh.
And, you know, now you'll see, this was another phase in my life when I started to photograph just in black and white, where I felt like, for me personally, I was stripping away my layers and I was becoming more and more unto my own, you know, who I am. And I call this my Zen image, because if you look in that image, it looks like everything was just breathing and it was just holding their breath in that moment. It's like there's a stillness, there's an edge. I don't know how to explain it. I mean, even if you look at, I don't know if you can see my little mouse on the screen. Can you see it? I think, you know, just looking at how those lines, you know, just line up there. So that's one of my, you see how I started to become more still inside. You know, I started to capture more stillness. So the aloes again.
Is a bird on there, or is that just the tree?
It's the plant. It's the flower. Yeah, flower. It's flowering.
Look at that.
This one was called As Above, So Below. Yeah. So they're almost like spiritual metaphors, really. And then I ran a dog project in what we call in our township dogs here, of the, you know, the homeless dogs.
I don't know why, but the sheep just make me laugh. Different than cattle. See, and the grass, right? The grass and the wind, and how does it grow there in that?
You know, Laura, I think this capturing or this photography is certainly a one way that one can experience oneness with life, really. You know, that's what it's been for me. It's been a very deep, spiritual, profound experience. You know, I went back later and photographed that tree 3-4 years later, and she didn't look like that at all. You know, she was more mature. She had a lot more weight on her. She looked more shaggy. You know, she'd aged beautifully. But I mean, it's just, all of this is just a moment in time. That's what it is. It's just a split second. And, you know, here I was starting to work a lot with the subconscious mind, not knowing this on a conscious level. And only after I'd photographed it and took it and actually worked with it, did I realize, oh my God, this is what, was it Freud or Jung that spoke about boats actually going back into the subconscious mind? And I realized, oh my gosh, you know, this could be symbolic for me, you know, of me venturing into my subconscious mind. So this is also in the Namibian desert.
Yeah. Skeleton of some trees.
So, okay, I've stopped sharing. No, I was finding there. There we go. There I'm back.
Now you're back. Oh, that was just beautiful. That was just like going on an adventure.
So it's certainly, you know, when I discovered photography, I actually discovered magic. It's magic.
Yeah. And you could take one of your whole classes there to any one of those sites, and what everybody would take a picture of would be different.
And you know why that is, Laura? It's because each person is in a different, they're not in the same emotional state.
Yeah.
That's what it is. So photography is very much, capturing images is very much a reflection or a metaphor for your emotions. And I mean, I'd often just take my camera and just wander off somewhere. You know, it's been my greatest healing path and my deepest connection. And once I'd actually realized, oh my gosh, but these Buddhist monks, one of them, he's passed away now, I can't remember his full name, it had a very long name, but he said photography actually led him to becoming a monk. And I could totally relate, because he says it is just that moment. It teaches you to be more conscious. And my, you know, I mean, at the moment I'm running a workshop called Photographing Consciousness.
Oh wow!
Because that's what it is. It's photographing that moment when the light. It's the closest for me, besides meditation, of how you can get really close to God. You know, really experiencing that immense, incredible, heavenly beauty of life. It's humbling. It's humbling to be able to, you know, most people just walk past a bee. But if you capture the bee and you zoom in and you can see how intricate it is and how alive it is. And anyway, you can see I'm in love.
Well, in love with the... okay. The way energy manifests itself in the structure of the world. And
it's beautiful. And
the animals, the flower. One year, I have this pear tree that in my yard that I just love. And some years it produces abundant fruit. And other years we get the wind out of the north and it comes just at the wrong time and no fruit. But one year I found a branch and I, just as it was starting to bud, and I took a picture of it every day.
Oh, wow.
As the buds were shifting.
Yeah.
Now, okay. It was for me, right? These aren't miraculous photos.
They're all miraculous.
but they were the progress of the tree that I watch every year. And then to the full bloom. And then to how the little piece of the pear starts in the center of the flower.
It's incredible, isn't it?
It's amazing. It's amazing. And it does it every single year, you know. And that, I don't know, that how the fruit comes out of the flower. Still, it's a miracle.
It's a miracle. It's a miracle, Laura. It really is. And I think that's why I get so excited, because everything's like a miracle. When I, you know, you actually see miracles in everything.
Right. So I just am so glad that you had time to share. To share this, it's kind of like an unfolding through imagery.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, it really is.
And actually, it's also not only an unfolding, it's also a journey in. So it's two things at one time.
I think some people, like some people write books, some people paint, some people write poetry. It's all an expression of the divine, isn't it?
Yes. Yes. So I will have some links for people to connect with you on your webpage, on your Facebook,
you.
Wherever you want them to connect with you with. And if I think I wanted to invite people to, in the comments from this video, to share a photo of them, of theirs, that means something to them.
That would be so lovely.
We'll get like a trickle down of photos from all over the world, maybe from all over the world.
Yeah.
All different things. And just thank you. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Thank you, Laura.
For your, it's like a window right next to me, right? How you see the world. I see similarities, but I also see, oh, wow. Look what she found. Do you still do the dark room, or have you moved more to digital at this point?
No, Laura, I have moved more to digital. I still do the dark room, but not as much anymore. And you know, I've moved even further. I've moved in you know, this what I call the soul photography, where we're practicing just in the moment, moment. You know, about students getting into the state of being, how they, you know. So we get excited because we know how deep they've gone within, or how still they've become in order to have seen that. So the photographs must feel fresh. It mustn't look like it's labored, and we don't use computers or Photoshop or anything like that. Maybe a little bit of contrast, but that's it.
Right.
It's just capturing, it's literally capturing the moment. Very exciting.
Oh, I love it. I just love it. And thank you so, so much.
Thank you, Laura.
Sharing. And I'll get all those links out so people can see.
Great.
It. Take care.
Thank you very much. All my love from South Africa.
Yes.
Bye, Laura.